Welcome to the unit on the Baroque period. So what does that mean? The first chapter is chapter 9 in 6th edition of the textbook and goes through to chapter 14. And it kind of works like this. Chapter 9, the first chapter is, what is the Baroque period? Historically and aesthetically, meaning what was important to them value-wise in terms of their culture. And then what's going on with music and its systems. And that means actually mechanically in the music and aesthetically in the music and even sort of what, for lack of a better word, is the music industry or society or culture like. And that's a tall order to get out of one chapter. So for this lecture, I'm gonna take you through the chapter, point things out and try and explain things and highlight certain things, maybe even diminish other things. If I say, oh, I don't agree with the textbook here, or yes, but you're missing this or that. Understand that writing a textbook or any technical manual is extremely difficult to do. You have to make choices about what to not put in. You can't say nothing. You can't say, well, it's like this, but caveat this and that. And so, it's enormously difficult. And anybody that reads the textbook that has already background and opinion on these things will disagree or say, oh, it should have been more of this, or I disagree with that. So don't take any criticisms or things that I say on top of what the textbook's saying as a discredit to the book. This will hopefully also help you understand how we're going to approach these chapters. And this is really actually an important point. The first unit was getting our hands and ears and eyes around music fundamentals and terms and definitions and families of instruments so that we had a vocabulary and an approach to listening to and evaluating and talking about music. Last unit was Middle Ages, Gothic period, Renaissance. Sort of a linear, this is what's happening through time and we introduce you to genres and this develops out of that and stuff. The Baroque period now is the first of the next three units that we're going to do, where we just sort of say, blah, here's the whole time period, and here's its characteristics, and now here's all the kind of music that's going on. So it's not a linear approach anymore. It's like, well, when is it? Well, the textbook will say something like the end of the Renaissance, which is 1600 to about 1750 with the death of Bach. Okay, and then what is it? Well, we'll get into that in a minute. And then it says, well, there's this kind of music and that kind of music and this composer and that composer and stuff. And it's important that we try and help you organize and think about this music, not necessarily in a linear fashion because it's all going on at the same time, at least the way the textbook presents it. And there are changes and developments through there, but we have to give you a snapshot. So that goes back to the idea of what are we not going to do? And, so we have to make choices. All right. So with this in play, and you've got the dates first off, let's dive into the textbook and see what's going on here. So it says, I guess I should put on glasses so I can read this. It says, even before the end of the Renaissance, a new style had been emerging. And that's true. Renaissance is about restraint, balance, symmetry, those kind of things. We can see it in their architecture. We can see it from their heavy influence from Hellenistic times, the Greeks, those kind of things. Things are getting bigger. Things are getting more emotional in terms of their art and their music, even their architecture. This happens in part because for the first time that's during the Renaissance, we've had, relatively speaking, historically, some stability in society. And that includes economic stability. Granted, there's lots of things that were unstable at the time compared to us right now, but relatively speaking, the European nations were quite stable during that time. And so we have development that's only possible architecturally, commerce, society, and in music that happens when you have stable systems of government and living. Music education starts during the Renaissance. If you're well-to-do, if you had a merchant class family, it became accepted that music education for your children was an important thing. Who do you think they wrote all those madrigals for? It wasn't just kings and queens. They had the printing press, and they would write out or print out madrigals for your well-educated children in music to perform for you, to learn and such. So the term Baroque, actually, we're not perfectly clear where the word comes from. It might have reference to do with the sort of overwrought piece of jewelry or style of jewelry, which is sort of over the top and gushing with elements and style and movement and things in it. So it's not quite sure on that. But what we end up getting is a time period where we have the ability to express their love of bigger, better, more emotional, those kind of things. And I think what we want to do is we want to look and see on the next page here, you know, the main characteristics of Baroque style that they're trying to talk to us about. And while this is not music specific, we're going to find that these values or foci, things that they focused on, do encompass and explain a lot of the music that went on at the time. So I'd say this is your first list and your first set of test questions. In the Baroque period, they were interested in grandiose dimensions. That just means bigger and more impressive and better. And it's a small picture in your textbook, but you know, they show you Bernini's Plaza, and it's one of these first huge, you know, places with giant buildings and a huge plaza courtyard, and all around the side surrounded with statues and things like that. And, again, this happens because of technical and economic development and stability over the years. Didn't just spring up, it became possible during that time. Money coalesced around individuals and organizations that allow these things to happen. I've lived in a lot of small towns and rural areas for a good portion of my life, and I've lived in some big cities as well. And you know, you can say what you want about city life being not so great, but there's money there. And so Chicago has its problems, but also has the Chicago Art Institute with the Chagall stained glass windows and things like that. And because there are people with money or corporations with money that are willing to fund those kind of institutions, you have these amazing collections and advantages of things that you can see. Similarly, in the Baroque period, you know, you have these institutions that have had stable years and years and years and years and years of affluence, and they are the things that help drive the big icons of society at the time. But bigger is better. Bigger, large, over the top. Love of drama. This is where we get the first really, 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 really big pieces of music and other art that starts to eclipse just the religious and nature of the Renaissance. Now, religious intensity is another big thing that's going on. We're fighting between the Catholic Church and the Protestant faith as well. And so they compete on many different levels, including, unfortunately, violent levels. But the art and the music worlds of these two aesthetics, and they sort of, one side makes a great piece of literature, and the other side says, you know, we can't have that. I'm going to make a different book or story about the afterlife that will express our viewpoint of theology. And that happens for music and for art as well. But getting back to this is love of drama. This is the first time where we have, you know, gigantic pieces of music that are about non-religious topics, or they may still be religious in nature in terms of the stories they're telling, but they're not for church, they're for entertainment. And so, you know, this is the development of opera. And you may not have heard of the words oratorio and cantata, but they're similar, have similar components, slightly different uses to opera. Operas are these giant sung dramas where everything's over the top. Okay, so these three things here, we will try and look at pieces of music and also the characteristics of the music and say, do these reflect these three aesthetics? So get to know these, define them, and then as we look at advancements in art, society in general, these kind of things, we'll say, well, do they fit into these three big aesthetics right there? Okay. All right. So Baroque art. Well, this is a music class, so it's interesting that they're showing us all this art. And I think that it's because these pictures are very illustrative of these things that we're talking about. I'm going to try and give you by contrast. So three pieces of Baroque art right here. This is when Abraham meets Melchizedek in the Old Testament and gives the high priest tithes. This is Christ being taken down from the cross. And this is the apotheosis of St. Ignatius at picture on the top of a cathedral that makes it look like it's going up into heaven forever. And this is a great example of all these aesthetics. So if we look here, this is, you know, you're looking up in the building and it's painted to look like it goes up forever and ever into the heavens. And bigger is better, grandiose dimensions. The building already is big, but then this seems to extend it up forever. Love of drama. Well, it's crowded with hosts of heavens and you can see the use of light and darkness, you know, focus and things like that. The extreme angles of this can give you a sense of inverted vertigo because you're not looking down, but you are looking up. And then religious fervor, you know, the heavens and such. And you know, let's go backwards on these other ones here. Christ coming down from the cross. The high priest Melchizedek receiving tithes from Abraham, religious topics. Okay, so it's a great deal of religious fervor. but even in these other two pictures, like this one right here, there, if you look, everything in this picture is twisted and turned. The bodies are this way, the horses, you know, stomping downwards. There's people holding up a tapestry behind the cherubs and things like that. And the way that it's been created shows this love of drama, this idea of pulling all, you know, the elements to give a sense of motion and tension and things like that. The colors are much more varied in contrast than anything you'd find in the Renaissance. And it's not just aesthetic, it's also technical. You know, and I'll go back to the other chapters and show you some pictures by comparison in just a minute. But here, which you could say, well, this isn't, you know, love of grandiose dimensions. It's not. It's actually a very intimate picture of pulling, you know, the Messiah down from the cross after he's been crucified. But if you think about it, this dark light is shined right here. The bodies are twisted. We presume the only other person that's not in here that's illuminated is the mother of Christ, Mary, who has fainted at seeing her son crucified and died. And, you know, so it's reflected in the light bouncing off of the bodies here. The whole way that this is done and set up and the high contrasts is, again, working out this huge, drama of, you know, historically at the time, you know, to their culture, the main pinnacle of story of stories right there. Now I'm going to quickly just take us back to the first chapters here. Secular music chapter from medieval music right there. And, you know, there's colors, but these people are flat. They're generic. In fact, they all look the same. They're barely idiosyncratic. We start during this time to get, you know, in the Renaissance, to get more personal pictures of people, but technically it's not as advanced. They can't do until we get to the the Renaissance and rediscover Greek, like technical drawing and things like that. We don't know how to do perspective. We're not focused on individuality as much. We go all the way back to see if we can find. They've taken it out, I guess. But I mean, the Gothic pictures and things like that of the statues, they don't have the same technical drawing here. Picture of Mary, you know, the Madonna and child. It doesn't have the dramatic pose, use of colors. It's very reserved. It's not realistic in that way. When we look at, when we finally get to the Renaissance, here it is, Renaissance. Pre-Renaissance, they didn't even have the technical ability to render people that were proportionally correct. They do finally discover, you know, the vanishing point and the horizon line and things like that from the Greeks, and they start to make actually super realistic or hyper realistic, idyllic, you know, based on Greek techniques and ideals, representations of the body. But even then, the pose is rather not dramatic, not twisted, not turned, not a lot of tension. He just sits there and says, you know, this is the most ideal sort of physical body that we can make at the time, right? So part of it is aesthetics, but a lot of it is also technical ability. Finally, you know, in the Renaissance, they finally start showing you towards the end an interest in humanism or humans. And so this is maybe the first picture we've seen that represents, you know, somebody that if you saw, you'd say, oh, you're the person in that picture, right? That's towards the end of the Renaissance. And then finally we get into the Baroque, and we build on that and keep going. All right. It's important to note that while emotion is an important aesthetic and this love of drama, that lots of other Baroque period intellectual activity is going on. And so, you know, Sir Isaac Newton, Kepler, Galilei, Copernicus, Gilbert, Boyle, Hooke, all these people, René Descartes, major important people from science, literature, well, these are the science people that are, and math are featured, are going on. So even though emotion is very important and drama is very important, and that's a new thing that's come into this era of time, science is and math is just going crazy. Again, partly due to the years and years and decades of relative stability in society. Now, I just want to point one thing about this out. This is primarily second level organization or discovery. Let me give you an example of that. In the Renaissance, we have people like, we have people cataloging and drawing pictures of and thinking about parts of the body, right? So we have anatomy being done. But here we can see William Harvey is describing the circulation of blood in the human body. So that's something that comes afterwards, because the original job of figuring out what anatomy is has been done in previous times. Now we're building on top of that, okay? Descartes is doing analytical geometry. Well, that doesn't come until you've got number systems and algebra has started to pop up, right? Chemistry is a specialization in science, okay? These are next level developments. All right, and then finally, we get to Baroque music. So hopefully these first few pages, as you read through them in detail, okay, and such, you've got them in a framework that you can think about. Remember, we wanna think about these three aesthetic tenets of their, this is what the culture loves and puts their money behind and thinks is worthy of their emotional, intellectual, and economical industry, okay? So we will always look at that. So what's going on? Early Baroque music, and then it starts to say, well, what are characteristics of the music? And then it says, what are the features of the music? Seems like it's all the same thing, but there's just this really, really long list. Let me give you a snapshot of things and try and highlight some things that are important. So one of the big developments of the time is homophony. If you think of the Gregorian chant era starting off as monophony, and then as we get into the Baroque, when we develop into organum and florid organum, and then we get into the Renaissance, which is polyphony and imitative polyphony. Okay, so that's where, you know, the first great sort of aesthetic is in the Renaissance, is all that imitative polyphony. Baroque period, because they have this idea of expressing dramatic stories and events and things like that, and showcasing dialogue as well as narration in their dramas, their musical dramas, homophony, where there's a clear, clean melody line and accompaniment underneath that to support that but not get in the way of that, develops. And it's kind of, if you just look at this like a headline and go, oh, they're into homophony, it's a misnomer. So here's one of those places where I'm cautioning you. This is an important texture, style of music that's developed and really exploited during this time. And we'll see this again and again. However, polyphony from the Renaissance has not gone away. It's not like it was banned. Composers and people writing music are well aware of it and well influenced by it. And so in addition to the development of homophony as an important texture for the music styles of the time developing and being used, again, for their love of drama, okay, for expressing dramatic scenes and things, some of the very best polyphonic music is built here. Now, it's not the same because other underpinnings inside the music are going on as well. But, you know, when we get to Bach and people, will find that they're doing great polyphony as well. Okay, I'm going to skip recitative because we're going to talk about that later. Okay, but let's talk about some of these elements right here. And now maybe you want to perk up and say, okay, there's going to be some sort of like, I guess, examples. Okay, so when we get to the Baroque period, if you think of it as a distillation of and development on top of all the other music that's gone before, there are certain things that develop and arrive. And the first thing is the idea of metric rhythm. That's where you have a beat, right? So music that you hear today where it's like, that sort of thing where you can go 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. That metrical rhythm that we've been talking about in the first unit is where the music finally coalesces and they say, yeah, meter, beat, organization of that. That becomes the style of the time. It's grown out of sort of the idea of beat in Renaissance and some of the music there, but it becomes codified here and thought of, okay? Major and minor keys and tonality and modulation. Let's see if we can explain these. So in the Middle Ages and you know, through the Renaissance, they had tons of different scales, which are groups of notes that they would use for their chant melodies. There were at least six, although depending on how you look at it, because there's six subversions of each of those, right? There's, you know, there's lots of these scales, and they had certain sounds and characteristics. They're called modes. Two of those they survive. Think of it like anytime you have, like, dinosaurs die off, but we still have birds and we still have other reptiles. So, you know, a good portion of the scales that they used stopped being used in disarray. They just, other ones became more popular. Okay. And two of them came out of that. One was a major scale, which, you know, and a minor scale. And they became the most popular ones. They stuck around. They had funny names in the past. Major scale's original name, if we go back in time, is Ionian mode, and minor one is called Aeolian mode, and they're based after Greek ideas. And so, but these two scales become the ones that get used, the other ones fall out of use. And around that, chord systems and a whole host of other music theory, in other words, mechanics of how to make music, is codified and made into systems and taught. The music becomes much more complicated at this time. It requires a much more complicated and sophisticated system. And they actually invent or codify systems. They look at the music that's gone on before and they say, well, if you're going to make music like this, you do this, this, and this. You need to understand this. All this idea of music theory that you're learning today, if you go into music, music theory classes and become a music major or a composer or stuff, this is where it all coalesces and says, you know, the systems are born here, right? They, or at least they're standardized here. What is a tonal center? Tonal center is the first note of a scale. So if I go, feels like home and all the chords. Eventually you come back to there, whether it's the first note of that scale or the first chord built on that scale. And that's what we call the tonal center or home, the center of your tonality. In this period of time, we get a new tuning system that allows us to be able to tune instruments in a way and write music in a way that will allow you to change where that home is. So a piece of music doesn't have to stay in the same key or tonal center the whole time. And so changing from one scale or tonal center to another is called modulations. So it's a very much more sophisticated music system with better tools. And so it allows us to do more complicated music. Doctrine of affections, such a hard thing to explain. We'll get into it more when we look at the actual music. But basically, they start to have aesthetics on this is how you would sing or play this or write this to get this emotion or word from the music that we're singing across. And so that actually becomes important. You don't passively sing through. You actually think about that. You could think of it like a descendant from text painting from the Renaissance. That might be good. All right. I think we'll stop looking at the list, and we'll just quickly right here jump in and look at Handel's Messiah, the voice of him that crieth in the wilderness. So this is in your listening guide here. I am going to put it on the computer, but you will get the music secondhand filtered. What are we listening to here? It's a style that you guys have not heard before. And so let me place this in context. This is a small piece of a large dramatic piece of music called Oratorio. And it's from a famous one called The Messiah. And that's the one that goes hallelujah. And we'll study that as we go along. But it represents a lot of these aesthetics. Recitative is when you want to get across dialogue. It could be narration or dialogue between two or more people. And so rhythmically, it will be static. Chords will be played. And a singer will get up there and sing some words for you to understand. So it's a great example of homophony. It's a great example of how we make things simpler. Like I said, there won't be a beat and a meter going on. It's just these things. And it's subtle and difficult to tell unless you have the ability to read music as well and things. But keeps changing tonality because they felt like that gave it more drama. If you want to make the next statement more impactful, you change key as well. And everything kind of culminates into there. So I'll play this for you. It's very short. It's also nice that in this case it's in English so you can understand it, but you'll get an idea of this. Now, I think listening to styles of music that you're not familiar with should be done a little bit like trying sushi for the first time. Seems weird, rice, raw fish, green horseradish, soy sauce, that kind of thing. And you might go like, "Ew, I don't like that." And I think you should say, well, you don't like it yet, right? Sushi is an acquired taste. I'll give you a different example, maybe one that you'll go like, oh, okay. So I, for religious reasons and just my upbringing, I've never drank alcohol. And that's really funny because I've played in a lot of bands. So that means I've played in a lot of bars. And of course I have friends that drink and, you know, stuff. And I've been told by many of them that beer is amazing, Okay. And I've had it spilled on me and I've smelled it. It just kind of smells like bad yeasty stuff. I can't imagine that it would be any good. And they say, no. It's, you have to drink a little bit of it and you have to have good beer in it. Eventually you'll come to appreciate it. It's an acquired taste. Fair enough. I'm not denying that. I think given the millions and millions and millions of people that enjoy it, it must be good after you acquire a taste for it. Similarly, don't just go like, ew, yuck, I don't like this. Go like, well, I don't like it yet. It is an acquired taste, and let's have a little bit of humility to say that millions and millions and millions of people have loved this kind of music through the ages. And so let yourself have a chance to get an acquired taste for it. All right. Like I said, it's basically chords being played by the orchestra and a guy coming out and speak singing this short passage. And that's meant now to break into a song, right? So you would have static rhythmic moments that declare things, and then you break into a song, and the song could be for an individual or a whole bunch of people, a chorus, a group of people singing together, and these bigger pieces like operas and oratorios and things are, they go on for literally like hour plus, they're built of these smaller blocks. But I don't know if you could hear, go back and listen again. These chords underneath keep shifting and changing the tonality or where home is. And he's allowed to sing in a declarative and dramatic way because the music's not rushing him onward. We could get into it in great detail and actually look how the words are set, and we'd find that certain words have more time featured to them, or are higher or lower, and that might go back to aesthetics, which has to do with the doctrine of affections right there. I just want to touch on this again. You don't have to define the details of doctrine of affections. What you need to know is that they had systems of aesthetics that said, this is the way we do this emotion, or you can ornament these notes or set these words in this way to help you get this or that effect emotionally, right? So, I mean, all of these things are systems that have become teachable, explainable, transmittable sort of codifications. All right. Are we done the chapter? No, we're not, but we're done for today. I know it says, but there's only two pages left, but these ones are doozies right here. And this is a great segue into actual music. Okay, what tuning system happened? What's Terrace dynamics, what's continual. And so tomorrow you'll get another video lecture where we go over this. And I just want to sort of forecast these chapters. Chapter 11 and 12, they are on vocal music going on during the Baroque period. Okay. Opera, etc. Okay. And then chapters 13 and 14 are about instrumental music going on in the Baroque period. We're actually going to mix these things up. Next lecture, we'll finish up the chapter about what's going on sort of physically in the music that's new in the Baroque period. And then we're going to jump into chapters 13 and 14, okay? Because this is the first era where instrumental music has grown and grown and grown. Size, structure, and social importance that it's co-equal with vocal music. And so we're going to talk about this first and look at the genres and the composers and things like that. And then towards the end, we'll go back to 11 and 12 and talk about vocal music, which is the opera, and in the previous chapter, oratorio and cantata. And these will be not so linear. We're going to be jumping back and forth between these two chapters, for instance, and looking at the elements that go into them and then how they're similar and different. So, if you've made it this far, good. Congratulations. And you should be rewarded now with this sort of like fair warning that you can't look at the music in these chapters linearly and just say, I'm going to do, you know, chapter 11 and then chapter 12 and chapter 13, and they're in a bubble like that. You can't just say what assignment is coming down the pike on the due dates in Canvas. I better look at that. You really want to dig into the video lectures that we're going to have on these, on how we organize and understand the music and how it relates to itself, how it's different from the Renaissance, and how, you know, what's going on in the music and how they function as well. So stay tuned for that. Bless you if you go all the way through this. Hopefully that helps you sort of understand what's going on here. And look for another video lecture tomorrow. And I guess that's it for right now.